says everything you do in math should make sense to you. And this is about, most of my teaching career was working with fifth and sixth graders, so those of you who teach elementary school, you will recognize a lot of this. But I think the whole idea, notion of sense making begins as early as kindergarten. And too often kids come to school thinking the goal in math is simply to get the right answer, and then the teacher's happy, and all is right with the world. But we want more from our students today. And this may look familiar. We want to show it to you a lot so that by the time you leave, when you leave on Friday afternoon, you'll all have a quiz. The effective mathematics teaching practices, which I actually like to think about as the teacher's version of the standards for mathematical practice. This is what we know helps teachers to help students to make sense of the mathematics that they're doing. So what I'm going to do for the next little bit is show you some examples of student thinking, not necessarily number sense, but thinking. And I'm going to try to attach one of these teaching practices as one of the teachable moments when you see students thinking like that. There isn't just one, these are interwoven, so here's an example. How many of our students learn the rule, when I'm subtracting from a number with lots of zeros, I cross out the zeros and make them all nines? Mm. And I always used to say to my students, what happened to the extra penny? And they had no idea what I was talking about. So when we teach students, we really need to talk to them and understand what their thinking is so we can help to correct some of these misconceptions. Some of you may have seen this one. It was floating around on Facebook for quite a while, where the problem is 3,000 minus 2,999. Now, I actually like the first one because that student actually took the zero in the ones place and made it a 10 when they did all the regrouping. However, if you look at the new way, when a student understands that 2,999 plus what number gives them 3,000, it's a whole lot easier. No purpose zeros, I don't know why, but my fifth graders love to put a row of zeros down. So when they do 393 times 30, it was 0 times 3, 0 times 9, 0 times 3. But even better, you'll notice that they added the row of zeros to 11,790 and did a whole lot of extra work. They had no idea of the role of place value in multiplication. We also need to watch our language and how that develops misconceptions. Language is one of the mathematical representations, by the way, in the effective teaching and learning practices. Gazinto was a word that was banned in my classroom. When kids said gazinto, we all sneezed. Gazinto does absolutely nothing to help kids to develop the meaning of understanding. And yet when they start reading left to right, 9 gazinto 27 is what comes out. Then there's reducing fractions. So kids have the misconception that because when something reduces, it gets smaller. When I go on a diet, I hope to reduce and get a little smaller. That when they simplify a fraction, when we call it reducing, that the value of that fraction might actually be getting smaller too. So reducing was banned in my classroom. This is one of my favorite cartoons from Glenda Lappin, those of you who know Glenda. I taught Stripe how to whistle. I don't hear him whistling. I said I taught him, I didn't say he learned it. I think we as teachers work really hard to try to teach our students. And I think so often, with the best of intentions, our students aren't learning what we're trying to teach. So the effective teaching and learning practices are a clue in helping us to teach more effectively. All right, 1 year I got promoted with my class, moved from fifth grade to sixth grade. Fifth grade is the year of fractions for anybody that knows fifth grade in here. So when the kids got to sixth grade, I thought to myself, they're gonna know this stuff. I put 1/2 plus 2/3 on the board and the kids all raised their hand, and to a student, the answer was 3/5. And I looked at them and I said, who was your math teacher last year? They all laughed and said, you were. And one of the things I realized was we had fraction pieces all over the place. Each kid had their own set of fraction pieces. We did the concrete, we did the symbolic. The kids did not understand why that was an unreasonable answer. So this was a great time to ask the question, why doesn't that answer make sense? Here's another one. I bet all of you, I'll bet there's not a person in this room that doesn't see some of this kind of stuff. We teach them how to take, I had a flight attendant on my flight here. I was happening to be reading Making Sense of Number Talks, or one of the new books out. And she said, that's not a book I often see on the plane. And I said, yeah. And she said, show me an example. So I showed her this one. And so we talked a little bit about how do you make sense out of these kinds of examples. Here's my all-time favorite, dividing fractions. And I have seen every possible configuration of dividing fractions that you can imagine. I flip the first number, no, I flip the second number, no, I change the operation, no, I flip both numbers and I keep division. Or my favorite was when I saw a student that actually had a multiplication problem and the numbers didn't work too well, so they flipped them both and divided. Why not take an understanding of what kids should come to us knowing from third and fourth grade? 4/5 divided by 2/5 means how many groups of 2/5 can I make out of 4/5? When I look at it that way, instead of some rule that makes no sense, I can actually draw a picture of it, and I actually have some idea of when I have to apply it, instead of looking for the word of in a worded problem. And one of my favorites, multiplication and division of decimals, we teach this by giving kids rules instead of using what they've learned about whole numbers to make sense out of using that operation with fractions or decimals. I'm gonna skip down to the division one. If I go like this, do y'all know what I'm doing? Just move the decimal point. Why not ask kids how many nickels are in $2.55? Most of you have probably seen this cartoon, it's been floating around for a while, but it's my absolute favorite. Only math problems can be by 60 cantaloupes and no one asks them. This cartoon has made me start to think a whole lot harder when I'm writing problems for my kids to solve. So when I have really strange contexts that make absolutely no sense for kids, I'm really thinking hard about how can I restate that problem, still do the mathematics I want kids to do, but have the problem using reasonable numbers. This one actually came from one of my students because they always had to explain their work. Yes, ma'am, I understand you want more than just the math answer. You want me to explain how I got the answer? Copied it from the kid behind me. That's not what we have in mind when we want kids talking to each other, talking to us about their thinking. And then there's the dreaded formula. Whether you teach high school, whether you teach third grade and you're teaching kids area or perimeter, in the middle school when you start to get into different shapes and looking for area, perimeter, circumference, how many kids really understand these? How often do we move quickly to the formula before kids really even understand what they mean? So, with apologies to Foxtrot, okay, let me see if I've got these area formulas memorized. For a triangle, it's 1/2 the base times the height. For a trapezoid, it's 1/2 a plus b times the height. And for a circle, it's pi r squared. He's saying, yes, yes, you're gonna pass this test and I'm gonna make 10 bucks. And then she turns over and she says, but I get confused. Is this about my height or the triangles? How many times do we give kids those letters and they don't really understand what they represent? So in closing, I just want to remind you that when we're thinking about how we teach and what we teach, it is true that everything that we do in mathematics should make sense, except trapezoids. Thank you.
That's a good one.